welcome to Wobbly Subbuteo Show with myself, Wobbly, and my good friend there, Michael Bradley, doing his wishes as always. How are you, mate?
All good in the hood.
Last week I got a wee bit excited, a wee bit premature ejaculation. I got all excited you were going to the Wobbly League last weekend, but it's this weekend. And fucking banker Boogie Bob has released his odds. Have you seen this?
I don't understand gambling, but what does it mean?
Right, okay. I'll explain it to you. So, Wolves, Harrow, Stanway, and Yorkshire are all 2-1 joint favourites to win Division 1.
Okay.
That means if you put a pound on one of them and they win, say you put a pound in Yorkshire and they win the league, you'll get £2 back plus your pound, so you win £3.
Okay.
At 4-1, Cardiff, put a pound on, they win, you win £4, plus your pound, £5. See?
Wait. All right.
So, White Star, or 10-1. What happens if you put a pound on White Star?
Tenner. £11.
Glasgow, or 10-1. That's a fucking big price for Glasgow. We heard the team last week.
So is it better if you're 10-1?
No, it means you're not a favourite. So the bigger price you are, bookie banker Bob thinks you're shit. Basically.
Who's fucking Bob? Who's Bob? Is it Bob fucking Varney?
It could be Bob Varney. Derry are 12-1 and Kent are 20-1.
Who's in Kent? Kent's a good squad.
So Jason's playing for us, but he's a Kent player. Division 2. Division 2. Woodburn? Who the fuck are Woodburn?
Don't know. Well, are they relatively new?
They're favourites to win Division 2. 2-1.
They must be. Pedmore. Who's on their squad?
Pedmore? Never heard of Pedmore either.
That's Simon Bodley and the boys.
Ah. So that's like a Wolves B team, is it?
I'd be wrong. Was there a Wolves B team?
No, there's no Wolves B team. So yeah, and you've Solent at 5-1, Bristol 8-1, IPL 10-1, Surrey 10-1, Chasers 12-1, Dewsbury 12-1, Glasgow.
Whoa! We're the same as Chasers.
Aye, but they're in Division 2. So it's just a general price. Glasgow Flickers are 12-1, and Andover and Solent have joined up, and they are 14-1. So, I fancy that Glasgow Flickers team. We've seen that team.
It doesn't bode well for Derry. That's not a good sign, is it? Fucking flag at half mast.
Well,
before we even start.
The thing Derry want to do is stay up. You don't want to go down. A lot of responsibility on Gareth, the captain.
Yeah, it's all on Gareth's shoulders.
It's all on Gareth.
Don't fuck it up, Gareth.
Glasgow Flickers in the second. I like Emmons, and I like Glasgow's price in the first.
Glasgow's good squad.
That's a good team.
Wolverhampton always do well. Wolverhampton's a very good team. They play well as a team.
Well, whoever Bob is, he didn't have the balls to separate any of them.
Fuck you, Bob.
So Wolves, Harrow, Stanway, and Yorkshire are all the same price. I would go out on a limb and say Wolves, odds on favourite. The rest are just chasing for second.
Yeah.
But by the time this show comes out, people have watched this and the event will be over and that'll be proved wrong.
Unless you get it out Friday evening, like you're supposed to do, week in, week out.
One's only out today. You know
what held you back?
Waiting on the other creators creating stuff.
You can't get the staff, man.
Match highlights only came to me yesterday. I mean, like, people don't see what goes on in the background.
No, I know.
And then you're away all weekend, so what's the chances of match highlights? Before the weekend?
I'll give you my highlights tomorrow.
Said with a drinker, a glass of wine in you. Right, let's go over and see old Barry Spence in this week's Barry Says.
You won't see my face this week, you'll be glad to hear, but Lawrence had asked me to just look at corners and how to defend from corners. Now again, similar to last week, not sure if I'm totally qualified about this. These change with every corner, with every match, every opponent and stuff like that. So, but I suppose the fundamentals are pretty much the same. If you can get your defensive line right for every corner. I think a couple of weeks ago I'd mentioned about trying not to use your defensive players, your defensive back six or seven for normal flicks, but to go around the table. Similar situation. If you can keep your back line and you lose a corner, and then a lot of your players don't need to move very far. So in this situation, you can see I've got, you know, five or six players already in defensive positions and don't need to flick that far. So for me, what you're trying to do, you're trying to flick the guys into here to stop them getting a flick. Now, obviously, it's not going to be perfect because you're going to get players who will hit the ball in the move and so on. But ideally, that's what you're trying to do. You're trying to get, trying to avoid them to get a touch from the ball as much as possible.
Cheers, Bazzer. Thank you very much. And as always, if you have any questions or queries on Barry stuff, ask on YouTube or send us a message and we'll get on it. Right, MySpace. We're going to keep things local this week. We're going to go over and see Martin Space that he talks about so much. When are you going to show MySpace and when are you going to do this in my house and blah, blah, blah. So this week, here is Martin Oakes. MySpace. Come on over the
marketplace. Good dog, ladies and gentlemen. This is my shed. My bicycle, which sits inside the shed sometimes. Very much. Just as yet. Usually the magic happens. This is my cannonball setup. This is a pitch we all play on. I forgot. Oh, look at this. All about the reference numbers. Yeah, original. There's our Lord, God and Saviour, Tom Waits, playing the piano. Our crest sign on the door. Thanks, Adam. Oh, very special. Official from the director's box. We'll not say how Lawrence Watson got that, but in here is a bed. If anybody ever needs, you know, somewhere to stay, I'll brush them spiders off it. But next time you're over, Jason, if you're looking somewhere, just stop up. I've got you covered. A few stickers on the walls. We're good friends. Argo table soccer. The Wobblies from the World Cup. St. Pauli. The TFAA boys. Some trophies. Here we go. All of my sick. Oh, fuck it. Tipped over. This is all of my second and first places. Third places, I should say. What's a good one? What's that there? 2023. Oh, it's semi-finals. Nobody wants to hear about that. Austria champions. Runner-up. Fucking runner-up. Plate. Fuck me. Runner-up. One winner. Donegal. Lethal. Plate. Fucking runner-up. All Ireland. Runner-up. Jesus wept. Championships, runner up, fuck me. Here's our club Waspa trophy. So you come to stay. This here is a fantastic gift from Justin Scott and the boys, Wolverhampton Table Football Club. When they came over to Derry for the Derry Open as part of our Interclub Cup with London Road and Glasgow. It was a very special wee Bruce Lee man. Come to us from came out. It was lovely. That's a wee Remy Braid. That's a London Road dude. That was Watson. I was trying to get out by Nigeria or something, I think. That's a wee Georgie Best from Jeff Christie and Minty's Legends. And, oh, I won that. France and, is that Croatia or something? World Cup final. Oh, that's a wee Pakistan man. You were gifted that if you ever won a Pakistani Subbuteo tournament. So there's only like two or three. That's our original Derry City Table Football Club strip. And a wee Derry City FC man. Lawrence painted. That's a big giant fucking thing. I don't know what that is. Real Madrid or something. Oh, one of a kind collector's edition with all them Liverpool boys thought they had the league one. But they didn't. That was left over. His wee man here. Come from Gareth Christie as well. Maradona. That's your man. Oh, and here's another little pennant from Wolverhampton as well for the 2019 Inter Club Cup over in Wolverhampton. Couple of posters, Spirit Fest, way down the bottom. World Cup. Oh, that's it. This is an original one off piece of art by Lawrence Watson. What we've got here? Spare tables. So we've won. 2, 3, 4, 5 tables in here. Although, I'd say you could fit 2. Would you be pushing it? Christmas, eh? 1978. Christmas 77, actually, probably. This is the Derry City Table Football Club dartboard. Irish Open poster. Fantastic poster for, the first round of an Irish Championship. Here's the heating system. Super Share, no better man. That's pretty much it. This is the painting station that gets lifted and moves across. We had Brock up here. Invisible man. Yep. Oh, that was my reparations from the British Army. What they did to me during the Troubles. Mr. Tato, superstar. Maybe Brian Daly, thing. Goalkeeper man. Oh, there's a lovely gift from Brenton Ashley. Sitting beside Derry City man, giant Derry City man. Our Lord God and Saviour, yet again, Tom Waits. Pretty much it. Oh, there's Louis. Ah, okay. Now, it's been brought to my attention by somebody that watched the show who thought this was in fact a picture of a Provo with an armlight, but it's not. It's Chewbacca from Star Wars. So I apologize to anybody who thought that. There is the training bench, these wee men. They're not a wee London Road man. It's my tanker, my darts. And tucked down there is the Bradley Subbuteo Family Cup, which is a big glass booth. We're drinking it or something. Derry City fixtures. Here's one of them. CDs and shit. That's it. One chair. Two chair. And a stool. So there you go. And that is it. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the shed. Oh, this is MySpace.
Hey, you, Martin O'Bradley. It's almost like I've seen it before.
Yeah, but what about the new mat?
The new mat's what brings it all, ties it all in. Right, I can't wait for this bit. I really can't wait for this bit. I want to go over and check out the old fantasy football.
That's what the name of the show, that's what it's all about, for fuck's sake.
Well, here we go. Let's see where everybody's landing on this week's fantasy football. Would you like me to start at the bottom or would you like me to start at the top?
At the bottom.
Go down the bottom? Nah. I knew you might have said that. So, way down the bottom. In 60th place, Ranger Things, Robert Ramsey.
Robert Ramsey.
Gangsters Holidays, Chris Morris is in 60th. Sorry, Robert Ramsey 61st with 61. Adam Douglas, 59. Dave the Save Hunter stays in 58. Chad Wright, way down to 57. He's dropping. He's dropping like a stone. Bill LaPlace is away up to 54th. 53rd. A certain Martin Og Bradley has dropped to 53rd. With 57 points last week. And Watson is back on top of him. 52nd. 60 points. It's good. It's a good weekend when you finish on top of Bradley.
You must be flat out looking at it.
Flat out. I couldn't live with you being above me again. That's the last that will ever happen. Last week was the last game that will ever happen.
You said it now.
Right, we'll go somewhere. How long do we go? Who's moved up? Elliot's away up to 48. Barry Spence has jumped above me again. He's away up to 47th. Barry had 84 points. Jeez, Barry, well done. Gary Downs has won up to 44th. Barry Corr's moved up to 42nd.
Well done, Barry.
Shane Elton is 38th. Must be son. Shane Elton, Dave's son. Let me see. John Henson's went up to 34th. Well done, John. Martin Bellefontaine is up to 32nd. Alice is up to 31st. Alexander Icecroft, 29th. Paul Pearson, wee Maggie's eyebrows, 27th. I Love Hazard, Natalie McCulloch, 24th. Lee McCafferty, 21st. Brenton Isley, 20th. He's coming back. Isley.
He must be growing the mullet out again.
Maybe he's stopped growing the mullet, worrying about the hair and the shoes and all, and he's focusing on the fantasy again. Big man for his Adidas. Big man for his Adidas shoes. Other shoes are available.
I have a pair of Adidas.
Our Pedmore friend, Simon Bodley, 18th. Thomas O'Flaherty, 16th. Brian Hitch, 14th. Terry Arnold, 12th. Top 10. We'll go through. Frankie. What? He's dropped the 8th.
Frank.
64 points. Jesus, Frankie. Jesus, Andrew Frankie. Kent is up to 6th. Dylan Barry, 5th. Gage Badger has dropped to 4th. Mark Weaver is up to 3rd. Chris McManus is in 2nd. And Thomas Regan is still in 1st.
He's running away with.
Are you still giving that praise away? My praise? Which might go missing one day? Well, Brent Nicely's leading the score for the points at the minute to get it.
But he's joint number one. Who's your man's number one?
He's joint first for the month's points with Alice.
Fucking facts.
Yeah, honey. Alice.
Well, how come your man Thomas Regan is number one, but Brendan Ashley is number gonna win the fucking thing?
Because he got 86 points last week. Alice got 88 points for the week, which means your combined points for the month is what you get. So you could be still top, but you haven't had the high score. Simple.
How can you be top if you haven't had the high score? That's not simple.
It is simple. Because he had such a big gap at the top, he hasn't been caught. I don't know. I give up. I really do give up. There are no fixtures this weekend because it's International Week and boys are away to the Wobbly Hobby League.
There's more important things to be talking about than playing soccer.
There is. But our good friend, Eoin Adams, who you're going to see this weekend playing for Yorkshire Phoenix, he is going to... What?
He's playing for Dewsbury Moor.
What?
Why? Eoin Adams isn't getting into the Yorkshire A team. They have a fucking army of boys.
Well, he's still playing. You're going to see him this weekend. you have a wee sit down of your own and discuss fantasy football? Because here he is with one hot minute. I was too hot, baby. I'm too hot to handle. I was too
hot. Too hot to handle. Round of footballing observations. This week we're on an international break, so instead of giving fantasy tips, I'll be predicting the matches for all the British and Irish nations playing this week. Let's start with England. They've already qualified. Tomorrow night they play Malta at home. I think they'll win by 4-0. Then 3 days later they go out to North Macedonia. I think they'll win again, this time by 2-0. Finishing top of the group. Now Scotland. Going to Georgia, which has been a troublesome place for them in the past. I think they'll turn it around this time and win 1-0, which would be the first win there in 3 attempts. Then on Sunday, they play Norway at home. Nothing to play for either team. Scotland have already qualified. Norway could make the playoffs, but it won't depend on their own performance. I think that game will peter out into a 1-1 draw. Next, we move on to Wales. The Welsh had a great win against Croatia in the last international break. If they win their last two remaining games, they'll definitely qualify. At home to Armenia, away to Armenia, I think they'll win 2-0. But then they face Turkey, and I don't think they've enough in them to beat the Turks. I think it'll be 1-1. Leaving them to sweat it out on Croatia's other results. Then the two Irish teams, who have both had disappointing campaigns to date, only winning against the bottom team of the group in both cases. Northern Ireland are away in Helsinki tomorrow night. It should be a close game. I don't think they've enough, though. I think it'll be 2-1 to the Finns. Then, 3 days later, Denmark come to Windsor Park. Denmark, easily the best team in the group. I think Denmark will be too much for them. Denmark will win 2-0. Finally, the Republic of Ireland, who have had a campaign to forget. The first game of the break is in the Netherlands, away, and I think they will lose 2-0. Then they round off the weekend with a home fixture against New Zealand. I don't think they're bad enough to lose that one. I think they will win by 2-1. That's my predictions for the international break, and I look forward to meeting a lot of you at the weekend at Redhill for the Wobbly Hobby League. I'll see you then.
Thank you, Eoin. Obviously, Eoin has given you his predictions on the international footballers this week.
Is that no good, Dave?
No good. It's not for fancy football. He's just telling you who's... I'm just keeping them in work for the week. You know what I mean?
Okay.
Keeping them busy.
Is James McLean playing for Ireland?
No, he retired.
He's playing one last match, he says.
Is he?
I seen it in the BBC. James McLean. One last game.
There you go.
That's actually out of retirement for a game. Hope he won. Who are they playing?
Greedy Poor. Netherlands.
Good.
Here, Fantasy Dream 11, we're going to go over and pick another player. We're going to add to the list. So here is this week's Fantasy Dream 11 with Martin Oak Bradley. He's doing everything this week.
Martin Oak Show.
Is this the real life? Is this just fantasy? Caught in a landslide, no escape from reality.
So, my pick for Wobbly's Subbuteo Fantasy 11 to only be one man. Nicest guy you'll ever meet. Utter gentleman. Very, very professional. Very, very good. I've played him umpteen times and I've only ever scored one goal. I played the world champion, Luca Colangelo, scored a goal against him. 9-1. But I played this guy 50 times, Luca once. I've only scored one goal against each of them. Ladies and gentlemen, the one, the only, Ireland's pro, Mr. Mark Farrell. Such a gent. They'll give you the final four every time. He'll never give you any leeway. So if you get a result against Mark, you're doing very, very well. Centre forward.
Give you creative choice of where to put Mark Farrell in your team. Do you want him in nets? Do you want him in defence, midfield or forward?
I don't know. Hands up, full admission here. I wouldn't be too au fait with soccer positions. Would he not go forward? Because who can score goals?
He doesn't concede many, like we said before.
He doesn't concede many. Put him in nets. Put him in fucking nets.
You can't put Farrell in nets. You can't put Ireland's pro in nets.
Centre forward. Ireland's pro.
Where do you want him? Put him up.
Centre forward.
There you go. Mark Farrell, join the list. Up front. Thank you, Martin O'Bradley. Right. Martin O'Bradley, when you finish supping on your wine, would you like to introduce our special guest this evening?
You talk about guests. Talk about special guests. What's this? Season 3? Season 4? How many years is this going?
Season 4?
4. We hadn't had this man on before. That's a scandal. There's many people in the Subbuteo world who say that's a scandal. This here man has been about decades. He's a pitcher in the Rooibos that never grows old. Australian legend. Worldwide superstar. This here signed the fucking board in the shrine. Ladies and gentlemen, the one, the only, Mr. Bob Green.
Rob Green.
Bobby.
Rob, finally we got you.
It's a pleasure to be here, finally.
It's okay. Everybody has a little technical error every now and again. We could have used the excuse that you're in Australia, but you're only in Stockholm, my man.
I know. It's only plus one on the time zone. It's not like the questions take an hour to get through or anything.
Rob, you've been on the Subbuteo scene for years. I mean, since I've been following you on Facebook, you've been playing Subbuteo. Have you always been playing? Have you ever taken a stop from Subbuteo? Or
I have actually. I stopped when I left school, so that was from about age 18 to age 25. So then started up again in 1985. Went to live in the UK in 1990, so I played all over then. That was where, of course, I met a lot of people the first time round. Played through to 1995 when I was back in Australia, and then I stopped, and then I didn't play again for 18 years. Oh. And then I started up again in 2013. The first tournament was the Helsinki Open.
Yeah.
Oh, no, that's right. I guessed it at the 2013 World Cup, and I was roped into playing by Alan Collins, because someone didn't come at the last minute, and Collins roped me in because, Australia was another country, and of course, I pretty much got hammered straight into a World Cup after 18 years.
Was that the World Cup that was held in Manchester?
No, this was the one in Spain. In that beautiful convention center, just not far from Madrid Airport. So everything you needed was just in the venue. The biggest convention center in Europe, apparently. And then since 2013, I've played ever since.
And what took you from Australia? What made you come from Australia to Europe?
Well, the first time round, I just fancied living in the UK. I'd been backpacking in the 1980s, and I just fancied living in the UK. So I went there and just lived for just about 4 years. And then I went back to Australia and just picked up with my, IT work that I do. And then I got offered a job with IBM for a 12-month contract in Stockholm. So I took it, and 26 years later, I'm still here.
Are you still employed by IBM? Because
no, that only lasted 16 months. only 16 months. IBM and software don't go together. So the project failed and I got another job in Stockholm.
Ah, very good. So how long have you been in Stockholm now?
Yeah, 26 years.
26. Very good. And is it, it's your home now, basically?
Yeah, yeah. That this is home now. Yeah. Hard to imagine leaving.
Family and everything in Sweden.
Yeah, yeah. Wife and daughter. Who they're not Subbuteo players either, unfortunately.
And what do they think your Subbuteo?
I'm not quite. I think they're just happy they don't have to come to tournaments. they have both flicked a figure at some point of their lives, and that was probably enough for them.
Yeah. I mean, you're not like Kane. You're not trying to get your daughter roped in and playing out all the tournaments. And
no, she's very much into her music, sort of like her, you know, like her mother. And so the whole concept of football, whether it's real football or football on a Subbuteo pitch, is completely alien to them. Yeah. I think they just can't see the point. Although my daughter's Googled me and she said to me one day, yeah, you're famous, Daddy, you know? And it's like, well, yeah, sort of.
In a very small world, you're very, very big.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And Martin Oak introduced you at the start when we were introducing you onto the show there. You've been to the Shrine and Paul Hayes's Shrine?
Yes, yeah. That's I went there, I think it was the year before COVID. I went over for their holiday silver because I saw it in somehow or other. I found out about it, and more or less just as a for something to do one day, I thought, I wonder how you get to Washington, D.C. or Baltimore, or there were various airports. And I thought it would be stupid money, but I just looked out of interest. And they said, I'll fly into Washington, Dulles. It's the easiest one.
Yeah.
So I Googled it. And if I translate into, I don't know, euros, it was about 540 euros for a return ticket. And I thought, that's actually pretty good. And and then I got serious about it. I thought, well, I could go to this, you know, and so I did. And I think on the Friday night, they have this thing called the Traveler's Cup, where anyone who's not from the area, they go to the Shrine and play for this cup. And then there's they have the main tournament on the Saturday in wherever their venue is. And then you're back in the Shrine on Sunday for a little team tournament where you just sort of get divided up into teams and play. And it was fantastic.
Yeah. It looks amazing.
Yeah, it is amazing. And you get to sign the blackboard as well. So everyone who's ever been there signs on the blackboard.
That's worth the 500 euros alone.
Yeah, I think so as well, yeah.
And Paul's a nice guy, isn't he? He's one of the nicest guys you'll meet in Subbuteo.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, I'd recommend that tournament because even when you walk around Washington, D.C., you've got the – I went to Capitol Hill. I went to the Air and Space Museum. And all this – I didn't realize this, but all that Smithsonian stuff's free. You just wander in and out. You can even join the guided tours for free, you know. And, you know – I'd go back if I got the chance and do it all again. That was fantastic.
Yeah, and
we've looked into it. We've looked into it, Bob. And you're right, it's not. We also thought that it would be stupid money, but no, it's not one buck.
I think it's off peak because I had like the middle four seats. I flew SAS, and I had the middle four seats all to myself from Copenhagen to, you know, to Dulles. It was only like 6 hours or something. It's nothing.
Yeah.
When you're used to flying, you know, like Sydney, Stockholm, 6 hours, it's just like a walk in the park.
I don't know. That's the one thing would put me off going to Australia is that flying time. The 24 hours, it's crazy.
It is. You get to Bangkok and you can think about how you're pretty much just halfway there.
Bangkok, is that only halfway?
Yeah.
Bangkok.
Yeah.
And I mean, I actually spoke to my partner about it because she's been. And I says, you know, it looks shorter if you go America and then America round to Australia. And she says, it looks shorter, but it's like half an hour shorter or something.
I'm not sure for you guys. I mean, do you have to go through Heathrow or can you fly straight out of?
No, we can go to Dublin.
We can go to Dublin.
But everybody goes Bangkok that direction. But you can go, I think you can go Vegas and then come round from Vegas or something. Oh, but okay. It's the same time.
Okay, because I know if you do it from Heathrow, it's longer to go through the States. But from Dublin, maybe it makes enough of a difference.
Yeah, well, we would have a half an hour from Dublin to Heathrow, you know what I mean? So
you're not taking much off.
Like.
Seems longer if you go the other way around to me. In my head, if you go to America and then you go the whole way across the Pacific, no, seems longer.
But the thing now, of course, is it takes longer now to go the Asian way because you've got to avoid Russian airspace.
So I
had this coming back when I was out there in January. And I came back and I was Singapore Airlines. So I flew Singapore to Copenhagen. And I think it was 13 hours and 45 minutes because they have to send you right around through Turkey and up. And it's just much longer that way than flying over Russia like we used to.
I couldn't hold. I've never peed in an airplane and I couldn't hold myself for 13 hours.
it was the longest flight I'd ever been on, just like one actual flight.
Yeah.
Because if you go through Bangkok, because it splits it up, you're looking at about maybe 11 hours each time.
It's 11 hours from Bangkok to Australia.
I think it's the planes are a bit quicker in the modern era. So maybe it's only about 10 now from Bangkok to Sydney, but it is quite a while. Because Sydney's much further east. If you go to Perth, it's all much closer because you're going just more straight south.
You're going the length of Australia as well.
Yeah, exactly.
Where did they put
who was your club in Australia that you played for?
They're the glorious Northern Falcons.
The Falcons?
It came out as that the famous purple and white shirt that I wear, and it just stands out a mile.
That's Elliot and the boys.
Yeah, it's Elliot. Because we were in school together. Elliot was a year under me. I was in school with his older brother, who was also a player. But as an adult, he didn't play the brother. But Elliot, of course, has kept it up.
Elliot beat me at the World Cup.
Elliot is really improved. I used to always beat Elliot, but now when I went back, Elliot really has improved through his whole World Cup experience, and he was beating me out there. Most games we played, because we had some practice as well, he won most of them. Yeah. Not all. That's a very important point, that not all.
He won most.
And he's a good player, you know.
Yeah.
Plays very well. The World Cup really helped him.
I found it very hard to get possession from him, you know.
Yeah.
Any time I got a chance, I think I had a few chances, maybe hit the bar and stuff. But very, very seldom you get an opportunity against him.
Yeah.
And he's clinical when he does get his chances. Like, well, he's only playing me. I'm the worst goalie in the world.
Yeah, that's a bit of a drawback if your keeper lets you down, isn't it? At our kind of level.
I wiggle it to try and save them. If you're playing against me, you know I'm gonna pull my keeper, so you just hit it directly at the keeper and it'll go in.
Well, I've got my favorite one here, and I usually line up with it before games. Just for comparison, there's a little figure. But strangely, I'm not allowed to use this in a game. I produced it in the Red Hill team tournament a year ago when I played Ruby Matthews. And Ruby didn't know about this, and she was a bit serious, and she was pointing at this goalkeeper saying, that's not a legal goalkeeper. She was getting a bit sort of stressed about this, and she was insisting. And I said, isn't it? And she said, no, there's a measuring thing. You know, haven't you seen it? There's this measuring thing. And I said, oh, sorry, Ruby, I didn't. I know, I got the real goalkeeper out. And then she beat me in the game, so maybe I got what I deserved.
What did she beat you in that game?
2-1. I didn't play well, but then Ruby did, and that's the point. Yeah, she deserved it on the day.
But you're playing a White Star. You're a White Star now, are you, Bob?
Yeah, I mean, because this isn't FISTIF, I can play for White Star because I know Jeremy Bradley and Kev Dyson, Rob Patterson, all of those guys from the years when I was in England 30 years ago. I played big ball as well. quite a few of us did. Jeremy was another one. We just alternated between small ball and big ball, depending where the tournaments were. And I've always kept up the friendship with Jeremy. So when this came along, there was the possibility to play for White Star. There was like, yeah, fine, I'm happy to. It's a good team and good guys.
And you were back home at the English CP a few weeks ago, weren't you?
Where?
You were home at the English GP. You were in England for the English GP.
That's right. Yeah. And
you had a 2-2 draw with our Jason. We call Jason ours because he played for Derby. You had a 2-2 draw with Jason.
Jason, did okay, and I think he took his chances. I actually led 2-1. I got a late goal to lead 2-1, and then he caught me with the ball fiddling about outside my own shooting area and punished me for 2-2. So, yeah, that was, a fair result, you know.
And you had a respectable 2-1 defeat to Rudy Peterson.
Yeah. I used to beat Rudy, years ago, but Rudy's been practicing, you know, and he deserved it. You know, it was always a good game with Rudy. I like playing Rudy. But he's been beating me lately. It's a while since I've beaten him. Got to do something about that.
But he's done a lot of traveling with Alan. You know what I mean? Him and Alan are never out of Europe.
My wife just turned up flicking a couple of figures around on the... Because it's a nice shiny table here. So, yeah.
Get her on to say hello. Yeah, hello.
I'll show you this. Do you want to say hello?
Say hello.
No, she doesn't want to say hello. Now have a good look at these.
Oh, no blue.
No blue.
No blue in the show, Bob. No blue.
These are Subbuteo streakers.
Remember them? I remember them. There's a rule. Have you read the rule for them?
No.
So there's a rule, a set of rules that come with them, and I'm almost sure if someone flicks one onto the pitch, it's either the game is abandoned.
if you're getting bit, you can flick the streaker onto the pitch, and then whoever you're playing has to flick the referee on, and the referee has to catch him. And whoever then, if the referee catches, you can, if you were winning, you can waste time. Say you're 1-0 up and there's a minute to go, you can flick on the streaker, and then he has to flick on the referee and try and catch him. Before he can get back playing again.
but there's an added complication to this. I've looked at these streaker figures and compared them with normal figures, and they're too tall. The figures, actually, the streaker figure wouldn't be legal, so I don't know if the referee could get you on a technicality there.
Well, they've no clothes on, Bob, so they're all standing up more stiff.
They're all stiff.
The rigs on, and they're all ready to go.
I've got a Subbuteo policeman as well, but the heads come off at some point. Probably some angry hooligans took it off.
I have a policeman who's slumped over on his base.
Yeah.
Well, I just want to get something out of the way here. We're talking about Leeds fans here. So
yes.
Is it any wonder the policeman has no head?
Exactly. Now, Leeds fans are pretty docile these days. They might have got a bit of a bum rap years ago, but these days, the games I've been to, I don't see anything, you know, which is a good thing, you know.
And you were at Wembley a few for the Socceroos.
Yes.
Wembley against England.
Yeah, that was a good day out. It was my first time at the new Wembley. I'd been to the old one years ago. I think it was 30 years since my last time there. Because it's all different now, of course. It's a complete rebuild, wasn't it?
Yeah.
And the Socceroos did okay. It was, should have taken their chances, but, so it is. It was just nice to play them there for the first time in our history.
Yeah. I'm a big follower of Australian football as well. Our former manager was your former manager, Ange Postecoglou.
Oh, yeah. I mean, he's fantastic, Ange. I mean, I follow him with great interest, of course, from Celtic onwards. And I hope the two defeats for Tottenham sort of won't hurt him too much.
Yeah.
But what a start he's had. And they all just seem to love him there. But we were lucky to have him. And I think the media drove him out. I don't know the ins and outs of it. But I think there were people, that journalists or ex-players or whoever it was, that thought they knew better And I think he just got fed up with it in the end and quit.
Yeah, he was too good for Scotland, but he's good. He was good for Australia, wasn't he? Like, really?
Yeah, oh, yeah. We won the Asian Cup with him in 2015. And, yeah, no, he was great for us. And we played a good game with him. And he was just always a bit limited by the quality of the players. You know, had he had that golden generation that we had around about 2006, you wonder what he could have achieved.
Yeah.
But, I mean, yeah, so it is. He did the best he could with what he had.
That's good. That's good. That's good. What's the game like in Sweden? I mean, is it big? I mean, for Subbuteo, I mean, is it?
No, there's nothing here, really. There's an Italian guy that lives on the other side of Stockholm to me, but I haven't seen him since before COVID. But he preferred to play the old Subbuteo rules like they have in Italy. So yeah. When I went with him, we ended up having two flicks for free kicks and all sorts of strange things. But, I mean, nice bloke, but he's about the only one here. He had a mate who was a beginner. And Max, the Italian guy, used to make his mate use like proper OO scale so you could curl them and everything. And then I let the beginner guy use my more modern figures, and his eyes just lit up, you know, with the polish and the sliding. And he knew what to do, that guy. He was actually okay as a beginner, you know, but it's just there's no one here playing. It's just if I want to play, I go to Helsinki and play the guys there a couple of times a year. It's just 1 hour on the plane.
An hour on the
plane? You have to take a plane?
Oh, yeah, because it's across the water. If you wanted to drive to Helsinki, you've got to go to the very north of Sweden and then drive all the way down Finland. So it's either a plane or 14 hours on a really nice cruise liner out of Stockholm overnight to Helsinki.
That's mental.
So
what's the game like in Helsinki then? Is it thriving? Is there much of a club there?
I don't think there's many of them, but they have their own little rule. They have a game they play with Finnish rules, and they have a small ball. So if you think about like the ETF ball, how big that is, and then there's the normal ball that we use now. There's this tiny little one. I think I've got one here.
We had a goal. My brother brought that to our club one night, thinking that Kenny Beggs was beating everybody. My brother brought the wee tiny ball, thinking he'll get one over on Kenny Beggs with this. And then Kenny was, that's good.
You don't really see it very well here. The white one is a small one.
Mm. Yeah.
And there's different rules, though. They've got this rule where if the ball, you're attacking, and if the ball stops, you have to wait for the block. But if you hit the moving ball, you don't have to wait. So they tend to be quite good at like putting the ball into your shooting area and then shooting on the run, because it's the way of bypassing the block. And they got some weird rules about goalkeepers as well, that the goalkeeper's got to be on the ground or something like this. I'm not quite sure. But most of the guys in Finland just stick to that. Yeah. But there's a few of them that will play Fistif rules as well. And they're the ones that I play when I go over there.
Good.
And they're good players, you know.
Yeah. It's a shame they don't play more. There's not more than playing the Fistif, because it'd be great to get more nationalities playing, you know, properly. Club, in terms of country ways and World Cup.
They're interested to a point, but I think from Finland, it always costs them a lot to travel. And we even talked about the World Cup one time. And it's this thing about three games and you're out, isn't it? And I know this has been talked about with Fistif, that the Europeans are generally the stronger players. So whether you come from like Japan or Australia or America, it's quite likely you play three games and you're out. There's no consolation. And I think
or Ireland.
But I think they're looking at this into the World Cup next year, but I'm not sure what they've come up with.
Yeah,
I don't see why they don't have like a plate competition after.
They should do.
They call it a WASPA, a World Cup WASPA competition. You know what I mean?
Yeah,
goes alongside it.
I think it'd be a good idea. I think it would be a good idea, a plate. But then, do they want to get involved in a whole running of another competition when they're trying to run, you've been to a World Cup, you've seen what goes on.
Yeah.
You know, they put that timer up. That timer never works. You know, there's games. There's games haven't started when that timer goes off. There's people still playing when they're giving you a 2 minute warning. You know, it's crazy.
Yeah.
So you imagine them turning around going, right, we're going to run a wee wasp here for a plate. You know, work away.
Exactly. And there's always this the issue of when everyone's ready to go, there's one referee that hasn't turned up at his table and everybody has to wait. And I don't know what the answer is to this.
It would be nice if they had a separate room or somewhere you could go and say, like, do you want to play friendlies or do you want to do some, you know, and there's always spare tables.
Well, there's always spare tables and there was plenty of friendlies going on. Do you know what I mean? You could pick anybody and have a wee game. Once you've come into the last 16, there's loads of tables. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Yeah, there's usually, once the group games are over, then of course there's less games going on each session, isn't there?
Yeah. And what about, do you know Turgi from Norway? Turgi would normally...
I've never met those guys because I think they were active in the years leading up to 2013 when I wasn't playing. And then when I started up again, by then they'd stopped. So I've never played in Norway. And it's on my radar because I don't know if you've heard about this, but there are the occasional Facebook discussions about who's played tournaments, not just a friendly at someone's house, but who's played an actual tournament in the most number of countries. And I think I'm up around 20 or 21 or something. I know that Christian Haas is
you.
Right.
It has to be you.
No, it's not. There's better than me. I think Christian Haas has played in more than I have. And even Chris Thomas, perhaps, as well. And the definition of a country is obviously what FIFA use. So we count like England, Scotland, Wales and Northern Ireland. For the purpose of this discussion, they count as four countries. And, of course, the Republic of Ireland is five.
Yeah, so them UK boys are getting more games, you know, because obviously you're not playing Republic of Ireland or Northern Ireland anytime soon.
Have you never been over here, Bob? Have you never been over in Ireland?
I have in the early 90s when Martin Taylor used to organise a big tournament in Dublin each year. And I think in 92 and 93, because it was in August, this Dublin tournament, 92 and 93, the Northern Irish guys, they then organised a tournament in Belfast because what was happening was that French players, Austrians, Dutch players, they were coming to Ireland for the Dublin Open. And, of course, they were quite happy to have a holiday. So you'd have Dublin on the weekend. Then you'd have Northern Ireland was on the Tuesday or something in Belfast. And then there was a big tournament in Hemel Hempstead, you know, just north of London, the following weekend. So those Europeans that came, actually, if they had like a rental car and that, they just had three tournaments in a week.
Yeah.
And it went pretty well. I think that we did that for 2 years and it worked well. So, but we've
had people on the show that sort of Belfast-Dublin thing is a bit like folklore because any of the big players like yourself that comes on, they always talk about playing in Belfast on the Saturday and then going to Dublin on the Sunday, playing a competition down there, you know, or vice versa, you know. So it'd be great if it went back to that again, wouldn't it?
It would, you know. And then at least now you don't get stopped by the British security forces at the border, you know, checking your car, you know. Because, of course, I had a car in England and I would take it over to Ireland. So, of course, it had UK plates. And I would often get checked, you know. And then, of course, I would just start talking to the soldier who came to ask me questions. And it was like, oh, and I'd say, yeah, I've got a French guy in the car here and a Dutch guy. And where's the Subbuteo players? Oh, you can go, you know.
They don't want to be bothered. Anything out of the ordinary, they don't want to be bothered. If it was that fucking Watson here, they had a ham out, all the seats out, they had a boot open, trousers off, bend over.
Well, I keep wanting to call you Bob because he keeps calling you Bob. But I'm gonna.
That's fine. That works.
we're gonna ask for your Bob? expert opinion because you are one of the experts of Subbuteo. So we're gonna ask you to pick goal of the week, and we don't want you to get confused with the ESA's goal of the month that they stole on us, you know, because they're thieving bastards. But we're gonna play the goals of the week, and we're gonna ask Robert Green to pick them. So here is our goal of the week.
We'll see how it goes. I'm looking forward to it. I'm sure at the end of it there'll be a big hug between us.
Okay. Mr. Green, in your ever so professional opinion, could you please pick this week's goal of the week? And you have to tell us why.
Are you playing it, or do I just give you my decision?
We've showed it the word you pick.
Okay, I pick, I think it was the second one, the long shot, where the player expertly followed the ball into the net and just nodded it over the line just to make sure it got in. The inch-perfect precision of the shot, a long shot as well, and the extra skill for that player to follow the ball into the net. That was class.
Good choice, Bob. Good choice.
That was our very own Oshin scoring against Martin Ogue. Did you know that?
Okay.
Did you not know who it was, no?
No, I didn't know who it was. You know, it actually wasn't all that clear who the players were in any of them, but that was fine. You know, I know quality when I see it.
Yes, Oshin.
Fucking Oshin will be running with that now. The rest of his life. Bob Green knows quality when he sees it. Well done. Well done, Oshin.
Well done, Oshin. Very good call. I like the third one because it was at a World Cup. And it was Northern Ireland against Republic of Ireland.
They said a superstar, Simon Stewart, playing.
Simon
for
Stewart
Ireland.
And Brendan Rodgers. Right. Very good goal. There was a good bit of rivalry about that World Cup with them countries.
Nobody's asking your opinion, Watson. Bob Green has spoken and he's chosen Ashley Murr's number two goal.
What about the World Cup in England? Do you think you're gonna play Australia or?
I don't know whether I'll be in the individual or the team tournament. I suspect, I have a vague memory of the Australians because many of them are interested in going because it's in England. Yeah. And I think I've got the players in Australia, if they want to go, will get preference over me, which is, you know, fair enough. But then, so it may be that I just go and play in the team tournament, which I'm interested, you know, to do that, obviously. We just got to see what the Federation in Australia come up with.
Poor old Elliot might not be too fussed. I don't think his wife be too fussed and going back to another World Cup. He ended up, they got COVID last time and stranded in Italy for fucking Elliot was there for
years. Yeah, they were extra couple of weeks stuck in Italy or something, weren't they?
They got the COVID, yeah. Everybody got the Rona. Well, you got back at the fucking COVID and everything.
I didn't know that about Elliot.
I was stranded. His wife tested, they had to test negative for 2 days in a row, and she tested negative, went on back home to Australia after like a week and a half, and poor Elliot was stuck there still.
Yeah, exactly. And I think as soon as Elliot got home, he had to get on a plane and go somewhere else for his job.
Oh, nightmare.
Like the day after or something. It was. I can't remember exactly what the story was, but it was something like that.
That's mental. Well, hopefully we get to meet up with you at the World Cup. It'd be great to catch up, finally, to meet you in person.
Well, see you this weekend, Bob.
Tournament. That's a good tournament, that team tournament.
That's good crack. I mean, well, I think we're in your Division 1, same as us. Me and you, mate.
Yeah, let's do it. Well, the most pressing thing for the coming weekend is making sure that everybody meets up on the Friday night first. So I don't know if it'll be that same pub again that people went to last year. I'll have to just put a question on Facebook about it.
Is Mark Farrell going to play Fuse?
No, he's playing for Yorkshire this time. So it's me, Jeremy Bradley, Kev Dyson and Rob Patterson, I think. I think that's the four.
Good squad. That's a good squad.
Yeah, we've only got four now because Jeremy Boothman was number five, but he pulled out, Jeremy said, yesterday. So we're just four.
And you'll get to catch up with Eoin Adams.
Yeah, is he coming as well? I didn't see his name on the list, but
he's Dewsbury. He's Dewsbury.
Oh, is that what it is? Yeah, okay.
That's like the Yorkshire B team.
Yeah.
You'll definitely meet him at the pub.
Yeah, I think so. I remember last year, you know. That was the first time I'd seen him in like probably 30 years last year. Same with it. There was actually a few people there I hadn't seen for that length of time.
It's a great community, isn't it? That you get this, you know, you haven't seen somebody in 30 years and you remember them and you just straight back in talking shade about Subbuteo.
Exactly, you know, because that's the thing, you know, you remember the people, and we're all basically still the same, just a bit older. You know, we're still Subbuteo players. We still have that mentality, that excellent mentality, I stress.
Yeah. I mean, it's strange for me and him. I mean, we're only playing 7 years, but we get to interview all you guys that come on, and it's great to see that camaraderie that you have from so long, knowing each other 30, 25 years. It's great. Like,
and it's fantastic, you know. It is fantastic to have that, and it's definitely something to treasure. Yeah, I mean, when you look at like guys like Elliot Kennedy and Steve Detry, I've known them since school. You know, it's the only club I've ever had. You know, yeah. I've had sort of the odd offer from Serie C and Serie D in Italy, but it's like, ooh. Well, I mean, it'd be a wonderful experience, but it's this thing of I'd have to quit the Falcons. You know, I don't want to do that. They've always been my club, you know.
Yeah.
So I just stick with them.
You know, it's that great a community. I have a daughter who lives in Derby in England now, and she's looking to start driving lessons. So I messaged Big Jerry Harrington. Jerry, do you know any driving instructors in Derby? And he says, how long will come back to me? Aye. And it's a Subbuteo dude is a driving instructor up around that area.
So Colin Terry. It'll be Colin Terry, won't it?
It is Colin Terry.
he's in our fantasy football.
I'm going to see Terry. I'm going to see Colin and get that organised.
Oh, he's a top guy, you know.
He was over with us last year. He was over here in Derry last year.
Yeah, I can come to that because it's on the same. I think that Derry tournament was on the same weekend as Midsummer here in Sweden. And that, is, of course, a big celebration here with the longest day.
That's right.
Sticking a pole in a field and all dancing around it or something, whatever they do, and drinking schnapps.
you can't turn that down, Bob. You can't turn schnapps in the field. Everybody looping with the sunshine.
I'm just more amused by it than anything else because they make it right fuss. There's special costumes that they can wear and everything for it, you know, like traditional Swedish clothes and... It's like, well, it's just a long day, But it's a big production for them, you know.
The fucking Australia there. It's pure Australian.
I know. It's
just a long day. He's on
it. It's just longer time you can drink beers. Here, we're gonna have a look at your what's in the box. So here is Rob Green's What's in Your Box.
Right, hello everyone. Here's my beautiful team box. Thanks to Ben Staples for getting it for me 8 or 9 years ago. Lots of stickers, including my Bob Green European Tour one that I had 30 years ago when I lived in the UK. So there's quite a few of those floating around with players from that era. If we open it up, we see I've got a few stickers here. Far too many, actually. I need to sort of do something with them. We have a sticker for a Ghost World Cup that never happened, and a sticker for a World Cup that did happen. A few balls, nail file, very important. Out the front here, we've got some figures, my beautiful Leeds home and away teams from the late 70s strips. We have some, let's just turn him around, a couple of streakers and a couple of policemen, one of which doesn't have a head. So that's what happens when you mess with Leeds fans. Of course, no viewing of my box would be complete without seeing the famous goalkeeper. So I hope you've all enjoyed that, and bye for now.
Robert,
beautiful box.
Great box. Them bases you're using, Bodos.
Bodos, yeah.
Bodo.
Where did you pick them up, or?
Well, when I started playing again, I had my old OO scale, and then it was Jeremy Bradley thought, okay, no, you're going to need a proper team, because I didn't know about all the new equipment back in 2013. So Jeremy actually got me a team of Bodos because he just thought it would suit the way I play. So it was just like a present from him, like welcome back to the community.
Yeah.
I did change for a couple of years to CC2s, and I played well with them, but they were just a wee bit on the light side, and I found it hard to get the ball forward sometimes. So after a couple of years, I actually went back to the Bodos because they're a bit heavier.
So then you're never going back. You're all the money in the world. Wouldn't buy them. You wouldn't sell them for all the money in the world.
No, yeah, I wouldn't sell them for all the money in the world. Exactly. Especially when they're painted in Leeds colours as well, the white strip and the more traditional yellow strip that we haven't for away games that haven't seen for quite a few seasons now.
Nice. Yeah. I must send you. I've done a couple of Leeds teams for people before. I hand paint, so I must send you some photos. You can see
please.
Will do. Robert, it's been an absolute pleasure to get you on the show. I know you've been knocking about the community for years and we haven't really spoke, so it's been amazing to catch up with you.
No, thanks very much. It was a pleasure to be on.
Oh, our pleasure, man.
Our pleasure. That man, I'd give that man pocket money for the weekend. He'll buy you a beer on Friday.
Buy you a pint on Friday.
All right, brilliant.
Saturday.
But you're not allowed to buy your own malt drink. Okay, no drink for Eoin, both of you.
And I promise I'll remember to do my little box video for you tomorrow.
No problem. Hey, have a good weekend and good luck in Red at Red Hill.
Not too much luck.
You're an Ireland. Not when we play you then. It's like, all right, yeah. Thanks very much, and we'll see you on the weekend.
Rob. Take her easy. Good luck.
Thanks. Bye.
All right. Bye.
Bye.
Robert, absolutely fantastic, wasn't he?
Oh, fucking superstar.
Quality. Right, we'll go and see some match highlights. So here is this week's match highlights.
Yeah, sure. Table three,
the live one.
That's it.
Okay, gents. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Thank you, Martin Oak Bradley. Right, before we go to results, I have an apology. A couple of weeks ago.
Hold on, by the way, I prepare myself. An apology from Lawrence Watson. Oh, this will be in the BBC tomorrow. Let's hear you.
Well, there was a couple of weeks ago we had the Americans on and we were talking about Tampa Bay Subbuteo Club. And I posted a link, or a photo of Tampa Bay Subbuteo Club's Facebook page. It was the wrong page. So here is this, the proper page.
Donkey.
Give them a wee click, give them a wee like. Check them out. They're doing good things over there. They've been going for years.
Also, might be pointed out that there was mention that Tampa Bay were quite a new club, where in fact they're not.
They're not.
They've been about for over a decade, many a moon. They're not so active on Facebook, where most of the video is, but on Instagram. If you type in Tampa Bay Subbuteo Club, they're fucking well going.
Perfect. Right. Match results. Here is this week's results.
I don't have many.
Good.
But
keep short. Keep them all for next week. A big well, results show next week. We'll dedicate more time to results next week for Red Hill.
Okay. So, well, late October, our good friends, Temple Uve Subbuteo Club in Belgium, helmed by Fenton of Subbuteo, held their competition, 12-man competition featuring Vincent, a good friend of the show, Sebastian Sorge, for a long time, World Wasp number one, Jeffrey Moraine, and many another. We'll go through a couple of Jeffrey Moraine versus Michel Dupre, 8-3. Some game. Benjamin Moraine, Jeffrey's brother. Versus, I've lost him. Thibaut Merville, 5-0. One's in the family. R. Vincent versus Frank Santer, 5-1. Vincent, hold him back. He may be a saint in the sheets. He's a freak in the pitch. Couple more matches. Run down the table for that 12 minutes. And at number 12, Thibaut Merville. And at number 11, Eric Callow. 10, David Sardet Delet. The names are difficult for this fat Paddy, they pronounce, I have to say. 9, Olivier Baudet. -1 points. What do you mean? Oh, no. Goal difference was -1. Apologies. 3 points. our Sebastian comes in at number 7 with 2 wins out of 4 games. 6 points.
Well done, Sebastian.
Well done. So top three. Dun-dun-dun-dun. Number three. St. Vincent de Copenhall. And at number three with 3 wins. Must have been 1 loss. I wonder who that was against. And at number two, Michel Dupre. 3 wins, 1 loss. Is a better goal difference than Vincent. St. Vincent, which puts him up in number two. Top of the table, the one, the only, Jeffrey Moraine. 4 wins out of 4 games, 12 points, 18 goal advantage.
Fuck me.
Jeffrey.
Lethal.
No bother to you. No bother to Jeff. I'll do this for them results. And then we'll have to go to, do you know who we have now? We'll just go for we're good friends. Good friends of the show.
Solent.
Subbuteo Club.
Love us.
Now they run their league in 2 divisions, which is pretty good, quite impressive. So they have a good squad in there. Few games from last Wednesday. We had Corey Martin, 5-0 humping over Mel Pope. The Pope got the trousers pulled off him by Corey. Nigel Morgan went down 1-0 to Tony Martin. Tony Martin again, 2-0 up over Mel Pope. For Mel. Corey 1 over Nigel Morgan. Corey Martin again, 3-1 over Tony Martin. And Conor Gregory, 5-0 over Mel Pope. For fucking Mel. Mel's not even bottom of the table. Kyle Jameson, 5-0 over Mel Pope. For Mel. Anyway, they have on their table, starting from the bottom, they have Reddy Duckworth. He's an under 20, a young fella. And at number 9, Mel Pope, number 8. Tim Hill sitting there at number 7. Roger Duckworth at number 6. Tony Martin, number 5. Nigel Morgan in 4th place. Kyle Jameson, under 20, at 3rd. Conor Gregory, under 18, Solon superstar. And at number 2, and top of the table, Division 2, is Corey Martin, sitting on 62 points for the league so far.
Well done, Corey Martin.
And then you're up with the big boys, Division 1. First match out they get, Paul Pearson, 1-0 over your friend, Chris Burford. Number 2, Paul Pearson, 1-0 over Malcolm Jameson. And Paul's fucking bagging them on. Paul Pearson, 4-1 over. Don't even like saying it. Dave the Save Hunter.
He beat Dave the Save Hunter 4-1.
4-1, trousers down, over the table, boom. Hard lines, Dave. Chris Burford, 2-0-1 over Stephen Smith. And a fucking tight one, Paul Izzard and Paul Pearson, the two Pauls, 1-1. Bottom of the table in Division 1 is Dave the Save. But they stand
Division 1. Dave, you're getting
value. Oh, fuck, they have a line. They have a line on the table for the relegation. So Dave is bottom of the table. 8 points. Come on, Dave. Steve Smith also in the red and sixth position. After those results, but still just safe, just ahead of the lines, Paul Pearson on 19 points. Chris Burford.
But he's loads of points clear.
Comfortably in at number 4, 23 points. Paul Izzard, 26 in third place. Number 2, Malcolm Jameson, top of the table. Solo number 1. Number one, not that long ago. Derry City superstar, Solent legend, the one, the only, Mr. Jason Christopher. Top
is he still Wasco's number one? Points.
I don't know. But well, once a Wasco number one, always is a Wasco number one.
You need to get them Wasco results for next week, overalls.
Well, that's next week. Anyway, that's the results for this week.
Thank you very much, Martin O'Bradley.
It's all my pleasure. You know that.
It's been fantastic. I would just want to say the Goblins in the States, Zach and the kids and stuff, are still playing at the wee games room. So fair play to them. Some wee photos are of them still playing. And your mate, you go there to bloody South Park.
It looks like they did out of South Park.
He does look from
Colorado is where South Park is from.
He looks like the dude of South Park, so maybe he is South Park. But
hey,
they're still going. Good to see. They're still flicking away there, and it's good to see the kids playing as well. So well done to the guys in the States. We didn't cover much of the States this week, did we?
Well, you burned. Are you okay with last that? Week for a bit. You know, I'm not too fussed. I had some things to say, but I've kept it quiet because you made such a fuss about me. Over Egan, the Yanks, even though the Yanks are fantastic, and we fucking love the Yanks.
Love the Yanks. But sure, they got Paul A's got a great shout out tonight from Bob Green. So
that is Mecca. Paul A's train is Mecca.
We'll be
everybody in Subbuteo should be pilgrimaging towards it. Someday, Paul A's is going to lift up his garage door and the bay. Fucking 600 Subbuteo boys with their boxes under their arms, looking they played in the house.
No, we should do a show from the train live.
Once this YouTube money starts rolling in and I see my cut, then we can show in the train.
I'll book a flight.
You book a flight. You book a flight, and I'll go. You book a flight. I'll book me to even work, and we'll stay it off.
No, you should go to a GoFundMe.
Get that OnlyFans going.
The OnlyFans didn't work, sure, the time you got your todger out, it didn't work.
Took me that long. I mean, took me that long to find it in my trousers. Everybody, they switched over. On the next one.
They went to TFM, Table Football Monthly. pay the pound to him rather than pay it to Bradley. Right.
Disappointed.
As they like to say in the game, it's been emotional. It's been a great week. Yeah. Good luck at the weekend for your flicking.
Do you know this weekend? Do you know what I'm going to do all weekend? I'm going to keep on flicking.
Keep on flicking! Goodbye!